May the Great Shepherd bless you and keep you, and may the Great Shepherd also bless my enemies. Today, I'm going to teach you a lesson that is a huge principle in deliverance and that I try to teach everybody. And may I pray that this lesson will last you for the rest of your life. It's that important. Today, I want to demystify or simplify spiritual warfare. And the way we do that is that we stop the fight in the mind before it progresses and becomes sin and then leads to death. So what I'm going to teach you today is three progressive steps. If the first step doesn't work, then we'll move to a second step, and then we'll move to a third step. And the third step should conquer the battle that is going on in your mind. Just because we get an I statement in our minds, it doesn't mean it's us that is saying it. I am stupid. I'm worthless. I'm a horrible son of God. I'm going to lose my salvation. I have lost my salvation. God's grace has ran out for me. All these thoughts most likely are the enemy. So just because it has an I in front of it doesn't mean that it's our thoughts. So the first step is to recognize a lie, take it into captivity, and then submit it unto the obedience of Jesus Christ. A lot of people, you already do recognize a lie, and we'll use the lie as I am worthless. So that will be our example for the rest of the video. So I recognize the lie. Okay, Satan just told me I'm worthless. I'm not going to swallow it. I'm going to take it captive. And don't ignore it. A lot of Christians, you like to just ignore it. Hopefully it'll go away. Okay, we got to be active. We have to fight back. So take the thought captive and then submit it unto the obedience of Jesus Christ. And sometimes the first step works, especially with temptations. You know, you get the thought, oh, I'll feel better if I go eat that pound of chocolate in the pantry. Hey, Jesus Christ, I just got this thought that I need to go eat that chocolate in the pantry. I just submit it to you. I expose it and I give it to you. I give that temptation to you. So that sometimes that's all it takes. So we obviously know the verse reference is 2 Corinthians 10. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Also James 1, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. So we understand from this verse that you can see the progression. So it starts out as a temptation. Now we'll see later in a later verse that temptation is not a sin. Don't let Satan put the thought in your mind, say, oh, look, you know, you're an evil person because you thought this. We cannot stop Satan from putting things in our mind. What we can do is then take it captive unto the obedience of Jesus Christ. Yes, there's probably, you know, there's no rule or rhyme to the reason. If we start entertaining the sin, then that's when, you know, we lust in our heart and commit adultery. But again, we can't stop Satan from putting things in our mind. So don't let the enemy guilt and shame you and condemn you after he's the one that put the thought in your mind. Just take it captive, submit it, and rebuke it, okay? That is not a sin. It's just temptation, and you overcame. Now, another principle, why step one will work, is because you're exposing darkness into the light. We know for John 3, and this is the condemnation that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be manifest, that they are wrought in God. And also James 5, confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. That's the reason why I use questionnaires in the deliverance. You are humbling yourself, you're confessing your sins, and you're exposing the darkness that is a power source for the demons in your life. Yes, Jesus Christ didn't use questionnaires, but you reject the fact that there was street ministry. Jesus had a street ministry, but he also had a discipleship. Yes, Jesus Christ didn't have a questionnaire before he delivered somebody, But what about the discipleship where he spent 3.5 years with his followers and yet they rejected him, they betrayed him, they wanted to call fire down from heaven on the Samaritans. Peter was a mouthpiece for the devil trying to withstand Jesus from the crucifixion. So yeah, he, you know, it only took him 5 minutes to cast out Legion, but on the same token, after 3.5 years of discipleship, they scattered like the wind when Jesus Christ was taken in captivity. So we have to balance Jesus' street ministry with discipleship. So the questionnaire is a huge tool. That is a huge requirement for you to be healed, is confessing your sins. Now, guilt and shame is Satan's way of keeping your secret secret. Those family secrets that pass down generations, those kill. Abortion. If great-grandmother had an abortion, she's passing Molech down, down, down. And nobody knows. Nobody knows. They're just barren or getting 4 miscarriages. Nobody tells them because they're ashamed and guilted into not speaking the truth and bringing their sins into the light. So step one is huge and powerful, taking those thoughts captive and exposing them. We are willfully exposing our deeds. And again, if you're a Christian and you're accusing people and you're using their past against them, then you're being a tool of the devil. And you're perpetuating the fact that don't be honest, don't expose yourself, don't be vulnerable, don't be truthful, because if you are, then I'm going to be used by the devil and I'm going to put it back in your face and I'm going to try to condemn you and accuse you. So we need to stop doing that, okay? If somebody comes underneath my ministry and needs my help, I will show them in a loving way, yes, this is your sin. We need to get rid of this. But if you're some brother and sister or even non-Christian or even some false prophet out there, I don't have a relationship with you. Therefore, if I try to correct you, it's not going to be taken very well. And we've seen on YouTube a lot of people trying to do this, and it doesn't bring fruit at all. So we have to understand authority also and relationship when we try to correct people. Remember, these letters were sent to individual churches, to the leadership, to correct their churches. If step one doesn't work and you're still being bombarded by the lie that I'm worthless, I expose it, hey, Jesus Christ, it says I'm worthless, here you go, you know, I expose this darkness that's in me that's trying to tear me down, saying I'm worthless. So if that doesn't work, we'll move on to step two. Renounce the lie in Jesus' name and his authority. All right, 2 Corinthians 4, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. So the first part of this verse, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. We know that in James 4, it talks about submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. So when the devil comes, he doesn't come in a red suit and a tail and a pitchfork. He is a liar. He is a deceiver. That is one of his main ways of how he comes to you. So in 2 Corinthians 4, when we renounce the hidden things of dishonesty, again, it's those dark things, right? We renounce these dark things of lying. That's a big, major way through lying and temptation that the enemy gets a hold on our life. Now, in deliverance, there's kingdoms that we have to find out what lie do you believe that is giving legal rights to that demon. Most demons, you know, sexual perversion is because, you know, sexual immorality, fornication, adultery, you know, murder is hatred, you know, unforgiveness, bitter, anger, all that stuff are sins that we have to repent of. But what about guilt, fear, shame, condemnation? Those are lies that we believe. So, and a lot of times the demon has multiple legal rights. So, demon, name Jesus Christ, do you have legal right? Yes, I do. Okay, demon of condemnation, what is the lie that such and such believes? And they'll be like, well, he believes he's worthless. Okay, what else? He believes he's no good. What else? He believes he's not a child of God. What else? Usually there's like 3 or 4 lies, and then the Holy Spirit will kind of confirm, okay, that's it. So one of those things we break are word curses before we even start the session. So we know that life and death is in the tongue. Men who love it eat the fruit of it. So if your dad told you, you're worthless, I don't love you, then that is a word curse. That's a demonic assignment against that son. A lot of times we see it when children are called fat or their parents are like, oh, you can lose a couple pounds. And they're always just always condemning them with their weight. It doesn't matter if it's 20, 30, 40 years later, they're bulimic, they're anorexic, they're, you know, this active word curse is still active in their life. And so before we even start the session, Holy Spirit, please reveal to me any active word curses we need to break. And, you know, I want people to be specific on their questionnaire. Yes, I was, you know, I was called fat, I was called worthless, I was called no good, I was called dummy, I was called stupid. We need to actively break those word curses because a lot of times they're still active in our life in adulthood. So again, so step two, if step one didn't work, we go to step two, renounce the lie in the name of Jesus Christ. You renounce the hidden things of dishonesty. That's how we resist the devil. That's one of the major ways. Devil, I renounce your lies. I don't receive your lies. I deny you. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus Christ. All right? And be specific. I renounce the lie that I'm worthless. All right? In the name of Jesus Christ, I renounce the lie that I'm worthless. Speak out loud. Be bold. Be aggressive. Satan is not a bumblebee, y'all. Satan's not like, oh, I don't want to mess with him because if I mess with him, he'll sting me. No, he's here to steal, kill, and destroy. Be aggressive. The gates will not prevail against us, right? So we're attacking the gates. Gates don't attack us. We attack gates. So now we move into step three. Speak biblical truth of yourself. All right, so again, God, I have this lie that I'm worthless. I give it to you. Please take it from me. In the name of Jesus Christ, I renounce the lie that I'm worthless. Step three, I'm going to speak biblical truth over myself. I am not worthless because the most precious blood, the most precious payment in this world is the blood of Jesus Christ. And he bought me with it. While I was still a sinner, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died for me. How much more so is he willing to give me all things now that I'm his son? Nobody else can fulfill my purpose. The Lord put me here with this family and this in America and with my sphere of influence. There's nobody else that can fulfill my purpose. I am worth something. I have giftings. I have a plan. God wants an abundant life for me. I am not worthless. So a lot of times that's your homework. You need to search out the Word of God, find the exact biblical truth that goes straight to the heart of it. And the reason why this works comes from Hebrews 4. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. So again, there's really no purpose in hiding things from the Lord. He sees it anyways. So the whole guilt and shame thing is a lie from the start. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. So again, just because you get tempted doesn't mean it's a sin. Because we see here, Jesus was in all points tempted like as we are, but without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So those of you who sin and try to bury it and try to, you know, the guilt, the shame, the condemnation, that is the opposite thing of what we need to do. Satan wants you to keep that stuff hidden. Because if you keep it hidden, that's where his power lies. If I would have to choose one thing that is the biggest obstacle from Christians receiving deliverance, I would say they're believing the lie. Them not knowing the Word of God, them not studying the truth, them not memorizing Scripture. And so if you don't know the Word of truth, you believe the lie. It's so easy to believe the lie when you don't have the truth in you. 1 Peter 1, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end of the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, but But as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. So verse 14, as obedient children, not fashioning ourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance. If you don't read the word of God, you're being fashioned, whether you like it or not, through TV, through movies, through your friends. If you know the word of God, you're able to withstand the worldly lust, the pride of life, the works of the flesh. And obviously, speaking biblical truth over yourself, it's a two-edged sword. You know, if you're dealing with a rejection and abandonment, Satan's saying, oh, you're a loser, you don't have any friends, and you're like, well, I reject that lie. Look, on Facebook, I have 200 friends, so therefore, you know, yeah, that's good. It's not the two-edged sword going straight to the heart of the issue. It's not the two-edged sword that exposes the demonic lie. John 8, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So three steps, progressive steps. You will use this for the rest of your life, I guarantee it. First, recognize a lie. Don't ignore it. Take it captive. Be active. Be aggressive. If you're able to recognize the lie, take it captive unto the obedience of Jesus Christ before it even becomes sin, you're a great spiritual warrior. All right, step two, we renounce the lie in the name of Jesus Christ. Step three, speak biblical truth over yourself. Go straight to the heart of that lie. So for bonus content, you know, most likely we're 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years old, and we've already swallowed a lot of lies already because we weren't a good gatekeeper. Or we continued in rebellion to go into witchcraft and the occult and into dark things, to study opposite things of the truth. Now, be aggressive. Holy Spirit, please reveal to me any lies that I believe about myself. And listen. Again, Holy Spirit, please reveal to me what lies do I believe about you or others or my relationship with you. Be aggressive. Seek out the lies in your own life. The truth will set you free. Now, I want to put to rest a lot of people, oh, I'm free, you know, I've been delivered. I don't believe in any lies. It's everybody else who's deceived. It's everybody else that's deluded. It's everybody else that has all the demons. Well, I'm going to put this to rest once and for all. Psalm 17, as for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. So if you didn't wake up this morning and look, hear, sound, walk in Jesus Christ's power and look like Jesus Christ and smell like Jesus Christ and have the love of Jesus Christ and walk in the power and authority of heaven and earth and hell, obey your every word. If that didn't happen, you need more deliverance. There's more lies that you believe that's stopping your faith and stopping you, the complete work in you. Philippians 1, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. So this, we can take this both ways. One, it's an encouragement that if the Holy Spirit brought you this far, he's going to finish and he's going to complete the work in you. But also, the work will be completed until the day of Jesus Christ. There's never going to be a point of saying, I've arrived. I've arrived in the gift of discernment. I've arrived in wisdom. I've arrived in this. That is pride. You are clay. We have always more to learn, always more revelations, always more veils to be taken off. I would rather 1,000 times out of 1,000 times go to war with my buddy who has my back, who is demonized, but recognizes he has demons and understands his limitations. And he says, yes, I struggle in this and this. I'm trying to get over it, but I recognize this. I would rather go to war with him any day of the week and twice on Sunday than somebody who is like, nope, I've arrived. I don't deal with demons. I'm totally free. I'm totally free. Praise the Lord. You know, I know the truth forwards and backwards. You know, just question me. I know everything, every situation. I would not. That's the last person I want to go to war with. That guy's blinded. That guy is blinded. And if he doesn't recognize his limitations, he's going to take me down with him. Another point with lies, not only are we getting lies in our mind, we also get lies in our body. Okay, you wake up, you know, last night you had a great worship session with the Lord. You wake up and you feel like dirt, totally depressed, totally heavy. You have to rebuke that. That also is a lie. Jesus Christ is still on the throne, whether we feel it or not. you get anxiety, you get the tightness of chest, your heart starts beating, you start sweating, your palms start getting clammy. That's a lie. No fear, no fear, right? We shouldn't have any fear whatsoever. So if that starts happening, you start getting anxiety, oh my gosh, I'm losing control. Okay, that feeling, do you think Satan's can manipulate your body? You think devils can manipulate your body? Yep, sure can. On the same note, if you feel the Holy Spirit touch your flesh and give you goose pimples, but nothing's going on inside in your stomach and in your core of your man and your bowels, I would rebuke it. And I'm not saying if you get goose pimples, that's not the Holy Spirit, but at least just once, just say, Holy Spirit, if this is not of you, if this feeling, this manifestation is not holy, in the name of Jesus Christ, I rebuke you. And see what happens. If it's God, it will continue. Or the drunk in the spirit. Does that hurt? Does that harm you? Holy Spirit, if this is not you right now that's making me feel, my flesh feel amazing, then I renounce you. If this is not holy, I renounce you in the name of Jesus Christ. Why not? I would rather be sure, wouldn't you? If you're unable to take these things and do these steps, and you still get bombarded, even after all three steps, you most likely have taken away the legal right of the demon. Now we just need to cast it out. And if you recognize it, you're like, man, I'm worthless. I have this kingdom of condemnation. And you rebuke that, and you speak biblical truth of yourself, and you actually believe it, then, yeah, in the name of Jesus Christ, the kingdom of condemnation, I bind your kingdom as one. If you're doing any physical damage to my body, I command you fix your damage now in the name of Jesus Christ. Strip you of your robe, shields, weapon, and armor, and I cast you in the pit of hell, never to return. Leave now in the name of Jesus Christ. Spirit of condemnation in your kingdom, leave me now in the name of Jesus Christ. Go ahead, do it. So along the same lines of people not understanding the truth, that's a huge, huge hindrance to their deliverance. If they believe, if they truly believe that they're worthless, you know, that's where counseling comes in. Before I deliver them, I'm like, you're not worthless. Here's the biblical truth. They have the responsibility of believing that. If they come back at with me with a bunch of condemnation scriptures, and they're using the Bible to twist scriptures so they can be condemned, they're not going to be delivered because they choose to believe the lie. I'll work with them, please, what about this scripture? What about this scripture? You know, like, get the truth in you. Yes, discipline is part of the relationship with our loving Father. He loves us. We're His children. But that should be 10% or less of our relationship with the Lord, not 90%. Everything I do is, woe is me, and oh man, God's going to smack my hand, and oh, this is punishment, and you know, this happened in my life. God hates me. I mean, that's a horrible, horrible relationship. That is not the relationship that Jesus Christ died for. All right, if He died for you while you're still a sinner, how much more so is He supposed to give you when you're His son or His daughter? So Lord, bless you and keep you. Stop the battle in the mind before it progresses, it becomes sin, and then leads to death. God bless you guys. Use these three steps. I pray that it lasts you a lifetime. Be blessed.